WF House presents an unabridged recording of Summer at the Cornish Farmhouse by Linn B. Halton, narrated by Emma Powell. To my fabulous four, you are my inspiration. Prologue. My hands shake as I press the call button, but the moment Grandma's voice fills the room, my throat closes over. Jess? My chest is so tight I begin to panic. Darling, what's wrong? My world is falling apart, Grandma, and I... With my emotions in utter turmoil, I struggle to pull myself together. Take your time, lovely. Try to slow down your thoughts and focus on breathing. Her tone is soft, so gentle that it's like a hug, and I find myself nodding my head even though she can't see me. Pushing my shoulders back with a sense of determination, I clasp my hands together firmly in my lap as I stare down at the phone lying in front of me. Moments later, the tight band of pain around my ribcage gradually begins to ease, and I reach out for a tissue to dry my eyes. Enough, I silently berate myself. What's done is done. Now it's about survival. Sorry, I don't know what to do, and I can't even think straight. As if leading me, what I hear in response is the sound of Grandma drawing in a deep, deep breath, then slowly expelling it before taking another. I follow her example for several minutes until my jaw unclenches and my shoulders relax, helping to take the pressure off my chest. Thank you, Grandma, I reply, my voice barely audible. Now, start at the beginning. Ben has been distant lately. No, we've both been distant with each other, is the truth. And yet, I don't know how it happened, how we got to this point. I mutter an involuntary groan as my husband's face flashes before my eyes. Ben insisted on taking me out for dinner last night, just the two of us, something we haven't done in quite a while. I was a little anxious, but also relieved. I thought we were finally going to sit down and talk honestly to each other like we used to. We get so little real quality time alone together these days. And when we do, the timing doesn't seem right somehow. There's always some little upset to spoil the atmosphere. Silly things that don't really matter, or so I thought. Can feel like invisible barriers, and I was happy that he wanted to clear the air. You know, get us back on track. I take a moment to steel myself before I repeat those fateful words that passed his lips. As it turns out, there are some things that you can't put right because once it's lost, it's gone forever. I saw the pain reflected in his eyes even before he started speaking, and it was gut-wrenching. He told me. I gulp down the lump that begins to rise in my throat. Ben admitted that he's not in love with me anymore, and he said he was sorry for messing up our lives. He wants a divorce. Oh, Jess, my poor darling. I can feel your pain, and my heart goes out to you. An icy chill begins to course through my veins. I rang Grandma because she often notices things other people don't pick up on. She says little, but she's a people watcher, and it's the word she chose not to say in response that tells me she'd already sensed that something was wrong. How did I not see it coming? My voice has an edge of desperation to it. And then Grandma lets out a sigh that emanates from deep within her, and it sends a little shudder through me. Because in your heart, you know the truth, Jess, and you've probably known it for a while. But you aren't ready to accept it. Suddenly, it's as if scenes from my life are flashing before my eyes in quick succession. Ben's eyes smiling down into mine, and I can actually feel his love wrapping itself around me. And the birthday, when I arrived home after an exhausting day at work, to a trail of rose petals leading from the front door to the bathroom. Inside, there were tea lights everywhere and a fragrant bubble bath awaiting. He appeared some 5 minutes later, carrying a tray with a dish of handmade chocolates and a bottle of champagne. As he slipped into the bath to join me, my tiredness simply faded away. That was in the early days, when happiness was something I took for granted.
It's over, and there's nothing I can do about it,
I gasp, as the reality continues to sink in.
I remember Ben standing in front of the window with Lola in his arms the night she was born. He had tears in his eyes as he talked to his daughter for the first time. He still looks at her that way, Grandma. But when he looks at me, his eyes haven't lit up like that for a long time now. I told him we could fix it. See a counsellor, but he said he can't change the way he feels.
I choke down a sob as my words peter out, my mind wandering. Jess, Grandma's voice brings me back into the moment. What is your heart telling you? I pause, and my stomach churns as the truth is almost too painful to bear.
That it's over. It's been over for a while, and I ignored my biggest fear because I knew there was no going back.
Then your focus must be on building the future you want for you and Lola.
How do I do that when my heart feels like it's been shattered into a million little pieces? My life no longer makes any sense.
So you're what? Just going to fall apart? She's right. I have Lola to think of. I don't even know how I'm going to tell Mum and Dad. Then it occurs to me that Grandma might not be the only one who could see the cracks forming in my marriage. Now I feel foolish and angry with myself. I thought that if I gave Ben a little space and some time, he'd sort himself out. It was just a phase he was going through, I told myself. No, Lola comes first, always, I reply meekly. Wallowing is a luxury I know I don't have.
There you go. That's the Jess we need now, strong and determined. It's hit you hard, my love, but life goes on. It's time to build a new dream, and gradually the wounds of disappointment will heal. But understand this, Jess. If deep down inside you'd felt there was a chance of salvaging your relationship, you would have immediately leapt into action. People change over time. Ben just changed in different ways to you. It's no one's fault. Our life became mundane. If only I'd... Grandma interrupts me. Don't do that to yourself, Jess. It changes nothing to think like that. But when you know someone isn't happy, I mean, it wasn't your idea to move to Cornwall, was it? Grandma gives a little light-hearted laugh. Your granddad's dream was always to live near to the sea. We all know that after Cappy left the Navy, he settled in Gloucestershire for my sake, because that's where most of the family were living. I knew you'd all come and visit if we moved to the farm, as who doesn't love the sound of the sea? Grandad's nickname, which family and friends now use with great affection, harks back to when I was small. I asked Grandad Gabe what he did when he was away. He said he was the captain of a ship. I wasn't good with T's, and from then on he was known as Cappy. He made his dream come true, though.
Well, partly, Grandma admits. There's still a lot of work to do to bring the farm and the buildings back to life. He won't rest until it's all done, but then I want him to buy a boat.
Her voice lifts, and I know she's smiling. A boat? I repeat, thinking I might have misheard her. Cappy has never mentioned a word of that to me. Once a captain, always a captain, she says, happiness radiating from her tone.
And why not? Even if he only goes mackerel fishing, he'll be back on the water again, and that's his spiritual home.
Now that's true love. And what's your dream, Grandma?
To see him wearing his captain's hat again. He'll want to take you and Lola fishing, of course. But he once told me that looking back on the land from the sea changes the way you look at life. He said that, give or take, the earth is 70% water and only 30% land. How amazing is that?
No, Grandma, how humbling is that, the way you always put Cappy first. And what's your dream for the farm, Grandma?
There's a long pause. I want it to be a comfort for him. For you all.
An uneasy feeling descends upon me.
It is. And you're happy there too, aren't you?
Yes, she instantly responds.
And Rhymwenneth Manor? I ask, unable to stop myself. Now the farmhouse is in better shape, and once the farmyard outbuildings are brought back to life, the boat comes next. After that, well, we'll see. But you love the manor house and the beautiful gardens and orchards surrounding it. It's been standing a long time, Jess. That old house will wait its turn if it's meant to be. The point is that this isn't about one person's dream, but building something for the future. When life gets tough, it's all about options. The farm is just one of them, something that might, well, who knows what tomorrow will bring. But that's the exciting bit about life, Jess. How many times do we look back on something bad that happened, only to realize that it changed our course, which turned out to be a good thing in the end? I fall silent, knowing there's a message for me somewhere in those words and feeling frustrated I can't see it right now. What if I make the wrong decision along the way, Grandma? She laughed softly. No one gets it right first time, Jess. We can plan all we like, but the key to surviving the ups and downs of life is to be like a willow. Know when to bend and flex. Don't let your ego make you dig in your heels for the wrong reasons. That makes me smile. I hear you. Good. When you know something is right, you feel it in your gut, Jess. There's nothing to fear in losing face or even losing your pride. But there's a lot to fear in doing something just because you're too scared to take a risk. If you get it wrong, it's a learning experience, that's all. As the long process of establishing a life without Ben by my side began, that conversation with Grandma was often on my mind. When, almost 6 months later, she died after a short and unexpected illness, I awoke from a dream one night thinking I'd heard her repeat something she'd said about the farm and Cappy. I want it to be a comfort for him, for you all. Did Grandma know she was ill when we spoke? Or did she instinctively know that her life was drawing to a close? Either way, her words stuck with me, as if one day I'd understand exactly what she'd been trying to tell me. 1 year later, June. Chapter 1. Those tricky little four-letter words. Buying paint, I'm discovering, can be as complex as finding love. It should be easy, shouldn't it? I mean, you meet someone, fall in love, and live happily ever after. And buying emulsion to paint a wall is just a case of plucking a tin off a shelf. Except that nothing in my life has ever turned out to be straightforward, and today is no different. The next item on my list simply says, blue paint. It's for my daughter, Lola's bedroom, and she told me exactly what she wanted. However, none of the pre-mixed colours on the shelves come close to her exacting description. After a lot of deliberation, I walk over to the impressive colour selection zone, and my heart sinks. There's a vast wall display with tiny colour charts. The blue section ranges from a mere hint of a tint that's so subtle it's hard to detect, to the darkest, densest navy. In between are hundreds. Literally hundreds of nuanced shades. I find myself sighing. As with love, I'm probably heading for another fall from grace. For an 8-year-old, Lola has an old head on her shoulders. My instructions this morning as I dropped her off at school were that it should be cornflower blue, like the flowers on the edge of the meadow we walked through last summer. That warm shade, Mum, she'd added intently. Not the way they looked after our picnic when the clouds were dark grey and they made everything look cold. My stomach started to churn. I tried to transport myself back into the moment, picturing her sitting on a blanket, munching contentedly on sandwiches and cake. The truth was that I couldn't even remember what flowers there were around us that day. I'd been too caught up trying to make a happy memory before I broke the news that Lola's father, Ben, and I were officially divorced. The move to Cornwall was imminent, and in a way, I'd wished the confirmation had come through after we'd left Gloucestershire. Lola knew it was coming, of course, but the reality of it felt harsh. As the sun slipped behind the gathering clouds and it started to rain, it seemed appropriate somehow. How dare the sun continue to shine when our world was about to be turned upside down? A period of mourning had begun. As we'd rushed to gather everything up and head back to the car, the questioning began.
We're really going on our big adventure then, Mum?
Her eyes had searched mine, looking for reassurance.
Was I really doing the right thing?
I'd questioned myself. Lola had already been through so much since Ben moved out, and I was running on empty. That didn't bode well when it came to taking on a project that was going to require a lot of energy and motivation. My nerves and emotions were frayed because, stupidly, I'd thought, hoped, that Ben would suddenly have a last-minute change of heart and beg us to stay. Or even better, come with us and start over again in a place that held so many wonderful memories for us all. A decade of family birthdays, Christmases and summer holidays gathering together to celebrate the happiest times in our lives. It was the right thing to do, and I knew it. Yes, and it will be amazing, Lola, I'd replied with every ounce of positivity I could muster as we bundled everything into the boot of the car. Instinctively, I'd reached out to help Lola tuck a few stray strands of hair that the breeze had whipped across her forehead behind her ear.
But Dad loves Cornwall as much as we do, Mum.
Lola's eyes had reflected the anxiety that she felt about leaving her dad behind.
I know, my gorgeous girl, and it is sad, but it's important that we're all happy.
Once Dad is settled in his new house, he'll come and spend some time with us. You know that, and Dad never breaks a promise, does he?
No, Mum, he doesn't. But Cappy's old farmhouse is a bit spidery and dark.
I'd stifled a laugh, wrinkling my forehead and putting on my serious face. Between us, we're going to get out the paintbrushes and make it light and bright and spider-free, don't you worry. And Cappy will be so happy to come and visit because your great-grandma Maggie will be pleased to think of the two of us living there. We all had so many wonderful family holidays, didn't we? It holds a lot of special memories, Lola, and we're about to add to them. The happy times were put on pause when Lola's great-grandma died and Cappy moved back to Gloucestershire to be close to my parents. Being at the farm without her by his side was simply too much for him to deal with. He struggled to pick up and make sense of the shattered pieces of his life. For a while, it was a struggle just to get through each day. He looked lost and bewildered. Appointing a manager to run the camping and caravanning business kept things ticking over. But no one talked about the longer-term future. However, we all missed a place that had become a huge part of our lives, and that applied to Lola, too. She isn't a child to sulk as she has a sunny, effervescent outlook on life. But the day of our picnic was a poignant one at that time. Aside from our home in Gloucestershire, there was only one other place she felt a strong connection to, and that was Cornwall. Oh, I know Ben will always be there for us. But taking Lola away from her friends and her school to make the move was still a risk. In my darkest moments, I'd realised that neither of us were adjusting to the inevitable, that three had become two in terms of living our daily lives. Now, here we are, nearly a year has passed since we made the move, and the last room of the farmhouse is going to be a masterpiece, if I can get just the right shade of blue to please my daughter. But even as I rifle through the swatches, my mind won't switch off. If only I'd put as much thought into choosing a husband as I am into decorating Lola's new bedroom, maybe we'd still be a happy family. Then it dawns on me that if I'd married someone else, I wouldn't have my beautiful girl. In that split second, my face lights up. And as I glance around, my eyes are light upon the perfect shade of sun-kissed cornflower blue. There's a lot riding on this, because Lola has been battling with separation anxiety. As daft as it sounds, every tiny detail of her new room matters. If you take a baby bird out of its nest, it feels threatened, vulnerable, and disorientated. So this isn't just about decorating a bedroom. It's about creating Lola's little sanctuary. Perching cross-legged on my favourite window seat, I stare out at the sea as it extends far into the distance. The trees are thinner here and frame the scene so perfectly it could be a painting. If I think back over the many times I've sat here with Lola, The pictures that fill my head are like charting her growth. From a babe in arms to a boisterous toddler. And now we often sit here side by side, just losing ourselves in the view. It's cathartic and a reminder of how wonderful nature is. Nothing upsets the rhythm of the seasons, and today it's gloriously sunny. There's hardly a cloud in the sky, and it's impossible to distinguish from here where the water ends and the sky begins on the horizon. My phone kicks into life, shattering the silence, but when I see that it's Ivy, I immediately put it on speakerphone. How did the paint-buying trip go? My best friend since preschool asks. It was a bit of a nightmare, but I'm hoping Lola will think I've nailed it. Thank goodness for... The sound of alarm bells going off in the background stops Ivy in her tracks. Sorry, Jess, the fire alarm is going off again, she yells down the line. I'll ring you back shortly. Oh dear, Ivy sounds at the end of her tether. Speak soon. As we disconnect, I stand staring at the large test square of wildflower blue I've just painted on the wall. I think it's pretty, but I have no idea if the vision in my head will match what Lola is picturing. When my phone kicks into life again, I grab it, assuming it's Ivy. But to my delight, it's Mum. Hi, darling, just checking in. Is this weekend still on? It is. The chippings are being delivered later this morning. Are you and Dad okay? She chuckles. I'm fine. And Dad is... Dad! He's in his greenhouse, loading up trays with plants for your new patio area as we speak. My smile grows exponentially. Oh, bless him. Going for the quickest and cheapest option to tidy the area behind the farmhouse isn't ideal, but it will transform it. Is Ben joining us? Mum asks hesitantly. My parents don't get to see him very often now, and it takes a while to adjust to that. They miss him too, which is only natural as he's been a part of our lives since I was 18 years old, and that's a little over 10 years now. Following the divorce, I decided to keep my married name, telling myself that it was for Lola's sake. Maybe, at first, there was that element of wishful thinking Ben might come back to me at some point. But now I know that isn't going to happen. I still think it was the right thing to do. No, sadly, he's working tomorrow. He did offer to drive down afterwards and stay overnight so he could give a hand on Sunday, but I didn't think that was fair on him. Oh well, it's the thought that counts, and it was good of Ben to offer. Mum's voice is upbeat, but the extra pair of hands would have been a boon, and we both know it. Ben is an antiques furniture restorer and used to shifting heavy items of furniture around. When he let it slip that he wouldn't be coming alone, I panicked and rejected his offer without even thinking. The good news is that Ivy has talked her lovely husband into coming. We haven't seen Adam for ages, Mum gushes, instantly perking up. Adam is a builder and he's solid muscle. His second home is the gym, and while I have no idea how much work is involved decanting 12 one-ton bags, my parents, Lola and I, really do need all the help we can muster. Well, it certainly put a huge smile on my face when she broke the news. It'll be fine, Jess, Mum reassures me. Goodness, I've carted enough compost down the path to your dad's kitchen garden over the years to know anything is doable. I might not be able to manage a wheelbarrow, but with the right size buckets, we'll be fine. I'll also bring a smaller one for Lola, as she won't want to be left out. A beeping sound emanates from my phone. Thanks, Mum. I have an incoming call from Ivy, so I'll love you and leave you. See you in the morning. Bye, darling. Give Lola a hug from us. As Ivy's voice looms up, she sounds frazzled. Another false alarm. Seriously, Jess, if the electrician doesn't get this sorted soon, we're going to lose customers and money. Each time we evacuate the cafe, we have to offer everyone a replacement hot drink. Thank goodness we don't serve hot food yet or we'd be sunk. Is the landlord still messing you round? Let's just say that he rarely returns my calls or my emails. And if he can't get the alarm sorted out, what chance do I have of getting his permission for me to install a new streamlined kitchen? I'm seriously considering starting to look elsewhere, because there'll be no point renewing the lease in October if this continues. Her sigh of exasperation is tough to hear. Poor Ivy. She's been rushed off her feet setting up a new business, and while it's in a prime spot in the centre of Stroud in Gloucestershire, space is at a premium. She can seat 16 people inside, and fortunately, she's allowed to put up 6 further tables outside when the weather allows. But it's always packed, and she's constantly turning customers away. I can't help but wonder whether it's the right place to invest in, though. Turning the cake and coffee emporium into a full-blown cafe offering hot and cold lunches is a risk. It's a great idea to grow her business, but if people sit and linger over their meal rather than eating and exiting, how long will it take her to recoup the outlay for her dream catering kitchen? You could always write to him and send it recorded delivery. You can't ignore that, surely. She groans disparagingly. If he treats all his tenants like he treats me, I suspect he gets a lot of those. Anyway, ignore my moaning. Trade is brisk, and I can't complain. So, the dreaded paint situation. You sounded quite confident just now. I am, I reply, smiling to myself. We've chosen some lovely pieces of furniture to upcycle, and she's even drawn a floor plan. It's good to hear that Lola really is ready for this at last, Jess. It's wonderful news. Ivy knows what a big deal this is for both Lola and me. When we move her bed out of my room and into the newly decorated one, we're going to put some voile drapes around it. She's very excited about that. That's a clever idea. When she's all tucked up in her own little space, she'll be comfy, cozy, and hopefully start to let go of that anxiety. I remember calling in to see you at the old house, and Lola was curled up in a ball, sobbing. My first instinct was to panic. It tears me apart how unsettled Lola has been since we moved to Cornwall. Sleeping in my room was supposed to be a temporary thing, but she didn't show any interest whenever I suggested we make a start in her bedroom. Now, with everything else sparkling and comfortable, the time has come. She's fine at school and has made some good friends, but when we're home alone together, every little sound sets her on edge. I know. Thankfully, Lola's meltdowns are few and far between now. Her feelings often overwhelmed her, and all I could do was to offer to sit and hold her in my arms until she calmed down. Sometimes she simply wanted to be left alone, and that scared me. She couldn't put what she was feeling into words, and it was as frustrating for her as it was for me. Ben missed all of that, of course. Ivy sighs. Moving to Cornwall was a courageous move, Jess, but the right one. Thanks, Ivy. I think so, too. It's a pity Lola's best friend, Daisy, lives a good 10-minute car drive away, but they're like the terrible twins when they're together. I chuckle. They're boisterous, they shriek a lot, and it's so good to see. Lola is used to living on a small housing estate within easy walking distance of the school. It's the sort of community where children are safe to play together in the cul-de-sac because the inhabitants drive slowly, expecting the unexpected, like a ball appearing out of nowhere or kids playing chase and forgetting where they are. Here, there are no friends living on her doorstep to play with unless we arrange a play date. In winter, we look out onto the inky blackness of the moor and dense swathes of trees. In the distance is the sea, and when it's blowing a gale, the wind coming off the water can be scary even in the mildest of storms. The worst is behind you now, Jess. Keep your focus on the future. Lola moving into her own bedroom is a major milestone for us, and I hope she can finally relax and enjoy having her own space again. The upside is that you'll be able to get rid of your double bed and get a decent-sized one in your room. I'll have you know it's very comfortable, I point out. Besides, a king-size bed isn't in the budget. But what if at some point in the future you want to entertain? Ivy teases me. I think I've done all the entertaining I want to do for a while. I scoff. A long while. Oh, one day you'll let go of your feelings for Ben. Don't rule out a second chance to find someone new to share your life with. I groan. When the man you love falls out of love with you, it's hard to accept. It's true to say that I'm not ready to move on, but each day I am getting a little stronger in my resolve not to think about Ben or what he's doing. Well, let's just say that I have enough problems on my plate to keep me fully occupied for the foreseeable future. Is Adam still coming tomorrow? Ivy chuckles. He sure is, and he's looking forward to it. He calls it a free workout, and you know him. He loves showing off his muscles. That's very true. But he's also a man you can rely upon, knowing that he'll step up every time. He's like the brother I never had, and Lola adores him. From day one, he didn't begrudge my close friendship with Jess, and now he too is regarded as a part of our extended family. It's been a while since he visited, so he'll notice the difference. And tell Adam that I've made a large batch of Cornish pasties for lunch. There are also some bottles of proper job beer in the fridge with his name on them. Jess, you make me look bad when you spoil him like that, Ivy quips, laughing. I like to keep him on his toes, not inflate his ego. I mean, his favourite Cornish beer and homemade pasties. And what about me? I'm a mum who cooks. You're a pro. Anyway, you're sorted as unlimited coffee refills are on hand, and Lola and I made a batch of traditional Cornish fairings. Oh, and we can pick as many homegrown strawberries as you can eat. Okay, I'll let you off. We'll be there bright and early. I must go, we have a queue, and I need to give the girls a hand. Love you guys. Chapter 2. Where there's a will, there's a way. As I watch the crane on the back of the lorry lift the giant bags of chippings off one by one, the driver can see from my reaction that I'm a little overwhelmed. Don't worry, your builders will soon get this lot laid. His brow furrows as he works the controls of the handheld device. It's a bit of a squeeze, he acknowledges as the last of the 12 one-ton bags is inched over the high stone wall into an area to the right of the second of the two cobbled courtyards. We're laying it ourselves, I admit. Oh, I see. You have a strong team on standby then? Not exactly. What we lack in muscle, we make up for in determination. We're hoping to get this lot shifted in 2 days, I comment drolly, and he raises his eyebrows. The first holidaymakers to rent the newly furnished Penty Groen, which Cappy told me is Cornish for Granite Cottage, are due next Saturday. I know it's a tall order. There are still some bits and pieces to do to get it ready, but as it's adjacent to the farmhouse, I want to make their outlook as charming as possible. In a week's time, this sea of chippings will cover the newly created patio to the rear of the farmhouse and the large corner garden. Then the space the bags are occupying will be transformed into a colourful garden for the rental property, with space alongside to park a car. I'm going to fill it with an array of colourful potted plants and create a little oasis. In which case, I hope the rain they're forecasting for late Saturday doesn't materialise. You're going to need all the luck you can get, as that's quite a job. It's a pity the gate isn't wider, so I could have dropped this lot a bit closer. I nod in agreement, but it is what it is. As for more rain, after a very wet and windy May, I'd hoped June was going to be dry and quite a bit warmer. It has certainly started off with some beautifully sunny days, but the wind can still be biting up here on the moor at times. They don't always get it right, I reply, determined to think positively. Anyway, thanks, and this is for you. Since I moved here, I've discovered that, for some bizarre reason, tradesmen aren't always comfortable taking a tip from a woman. The guy stares at me awkwardly. That's very kind, but you paid extra for delivery, you know. I stretch out my hand a little further, and he reluctantly accepts it, tilting his head in acknowledgement. He hesitates for a moment before making eye contact. If you ever get stuck, he adds, I'm a carpenter by trade, but I can turn my hand to a bit of general building and plumbing. I work at the builders' merchants when they're short-staffed, mainly driving the lorry. My rates are reasonable and I can supply references. He pulls a card from his pocket and I take it gratefully. That's useful to know, appreciated. I hold out my hand. My name is Riley, Riley Warren. I glance down at the card, which says, R. Warren, Home Repairs, No Job Too Small. When I look up, his friendly smile reassures me he's genuine and not being pushy. He comes across as an honest, hard-working guy. He's certainly strong and his handshake is firm. I'm Jess, I reply. Well, good luck, Jess. I'm sure you'll continue to breathe some life back into Runwentworth Farm. For many years, they had a permanent farmer's market here and folk came from all over. They sold a bit of everything and it was a real draw. I didn't know that, Riley. What a great idea. Lots of the more remote places have fallen into disuse. The youngsters go off to the big cities where they can earn a lot more. That's life, eh? What attracted you here? It was becoming a bit much for my granddad to manage now he's on his own. Truthfully, I'm beginning to think it's a bit much for me, too. I didn't know you were related to Cappy. I was terribly sorry to hear about his loss, but he's no doubt glad to hand the reins over to you. There's a lot of potential here. Right. Riley pulls a folded piece of paper from his pocket. This is your delivery note, Jess. There's a code on the bottom giving you 10% off your next order. I burst out laughing. It might be a while until I need another load, depending on how it goes. But I'll remember that, Riley. Thanks. The lorry disappears from view, and I gaze around at the collection of empty and unused outbuildings. Updating my grandparents' four-bed farmhouse and two-bed rental has been relatively easy. Aside from employing a plumber, a plasterer, and an electrician, I turn myself into a DIYer. Learning a few new skills has been cathartic, and keeping busy got me through what has been a painful period in my life. As for Renwenneth Manor in the adjoining courtyard and the three stone outbuildings opposite Pentygrowan, it's true that none of them is beyond saving, but all will involve a serious injection of cash. When my grandparents first arrived here 10 years ago, only the farmhouse and the cottage were habitable, albeit tired-looking rental properties. Once the builders finished the renovations, Cappy and Grandma focused on turning the first of the two large fields that came with the farm into a handy little income stream. One of the attractions of this place was that while the farm complex is a sprawling collection of buildings, it didn't come with untold acres of land. With the abandoned manor house sitting in an orchard the other side of a high stone wall, the dream was to convert the buildings around the vast cobbled courtyard and turn this place into a holiday complex with on-site amenities. Phase two, several years later, involved getting planning permission to turn Renwenneth Manor into bed and breakfast accommodation, and approval for change of use for the row of smaller stone buildings and the small barn to be used as commercial retail space. My grandparents envisaged a farm shop, a second rental cottage, and an indoor market which would be a mere walk away for the campers. Much to their annoyance, the application dragged on and on. Then one day, after submitting the fifth set of plans, they finally got the green light. The builders were all lined up and a start date agreed. Then Grandma got sick. When a loved one's life is suddenly turned upside down, all you can do is get through it one day at a time and priorities change. The longer-term plan is in place, but that's as far as it's gone. Cappy and I sat down and did some number crunching. The problem is that while I walked away from my marriage with a lump sum after selling our family home and a monthly contribution from Ben for child support, it's a lot to juggle. Admittedly, it was my decision to give up work to take over this place, and if I hadn't, then Cappy would have sold up. He said it was my inheritance either way. Maybe I didn't want to disappoint him, or perhaps I was just running away and desperate for a lifeline. I don't know which, but Lola and I saw it as a big adventure and a fresh start. Cappy suggested I think about using both fields to grow the income from the campsite. The outlay for that mainly involved extending the shower and toilet facilities and taking down a part of a stone wall to access the second field. With the work now completed, doubling the number of pitches available has also allowed me to employ a full-time site manager, Arthur Preston. In my first year here, the rental pitches made a respectable profit. But the new summer season is already looking promising with a bumper number of bookings secured. It will allow me to plough forward, but I need to spend every penny wisely, as I'm well aware that Renwenneth Farm could end up being a money pit. Still, once the chippings are laid, it will instantly tidy what is currently little more than a mud bath when it rains and an ugly eyesore when the sun shines. It's vital, because it spoils the ambience and could put people off coming to stay in Pentygrowan. Besides, I'm also hoping that this weekend will give me the lift I need to keep my motivation levels up, as I'm flagging a little. One day, I muse out loud, spinning around, this courtyard will be the hub of Renwenneth Farm. I intend to turn it into a place where not only holidaymakers, but equally as important, local friends and family will be eager to visit. However, patience is a virtue and I must be patient because it isn't going to happen overnight. Glancing at my watch, I see that it's time I jumped in the car for the afternoon school run. Today, I'm picking up Lola and three other children will be dropping off on our way home. That's what I love about living in the countryside. My neighbours might be scattered around, but help is simply a phone call away. Each day is getting a little easier, but there's still a long way to go until Lola and I feel at home. By that, I mean safe in the knowledge that we're here for good. There are still days we both waver, and nights I spend tossing and turning, wondering whether I made the right decision. "Come on, Jess," that inner voice pipes up. "You are a budget manager for a property developer, so making the figures work is what you do best." In theory, it's not beyond my capabilities, but in practice? Well, only time will tell whether I have the stamina, as this isn't a task for the faint-hearted. I do hope I can pull it off, because everything I have is on the line here, and my dream is to make a good life for Lola and myself.
"Grandma! Pops!"
Lola shrieks as she runs towards my parents, arms outstretched. I hurry over, and Mum looks up to give me a welcoming smile, as Lola isn't in a hurry to let go. "My, my, you've grown, young lady," Dad declares to Lola's delight as he widens his arms for me to join them. "And you've got some colour in your cheeks, I'm glad to see, Jess." "I've been building a stone wall around the new patio area," I inform him. "We've got to take a look at that then. Come on, Lola, give me the tour." Lola finally releases her hold, grabbing Pops's hand and steering him towards the picket fence in the far corner. I lean in to give Mum a hug. "It's good to see you. We best tag along. Lola is very proud of herself. She helped me by doing some of the pointing." Mum raises her eyebrows.
"She did?"
"Yes, and between us, we did an okay job." Mum and I link arms, and she turns her head to study my face. "But you're under pressure. I can see that." I sigh. If this weekend goes well, then I'm in with a chance of getting the finishing touches to Pentigrow and done. It's going to be close, though. Everything doesn't have to be perfect, Jess. Just looking around, I can't believe how lovely the farmhouse and the cottage look now. It's been 4 months since our last visit, and I'd say you've more than turned the corner. Pulling all the old climbers off Pentigrown was a nightmare of a job and filled several skips. But a quick wire brush, and I'm pleased with the result. There's still a bit of painting to finish off inside, plus a table and chairs to be unboxed and assembled in the little patio area where the chippings have been offloaded. I groan. But I'm hopeful it will all get done in time. Well, we've come prepared to make a start. I glance at Mum's old jeans and her gardening fleece. And Dad has brought a whole stack of pots and pans ready to pretty up that side patio. It's a pity Cappy is a bit under the weather, but your dad managed to fill every inch of the car. Mum stops to stare at the enormous bags and starts laughing.
That's a bit daunting, isn't it? I'm so glad Adam is joining us.
We chatter away as we catch up with Lola and Dad. They're inspecting our newly built low stone wall.
"I did this bit all along here, Pops," Lola points out, her face a picture of satisfaction.
"All by yourself?" He stands there looking seriously impressed, and her smile grows exponentially.
"Yep.
You did an amazing job. All it needs now is for us to fetch the pots from the car to plant up that raised bed. Shall we make a start?
Dad, don't you want to come inside for a cup of tea first? Or at least bring in your overnight bags?"
I check, but he's already walking hand in hand with Lola back towards the car.
"We couldn't get to them if we wanted to. The car's packed with plants. Just bring me a mug out here," he calls over his shoulder. "We've got work to do, haven't we, Lola?"
"Maybe cast your eye over the membrane I laid, Dad. I pegged it well, as he said, and overlapped the joins, so fingers crossed it'll stop the weeds from coming through."
The sound of another car arriving has Mum and me turning around, as it's only just coming up to 8 o'clock. "It's Ivy and Adam," I remark as I give them a wave. I wasn't expecting them for at least another hour.
"You go and greet them, Jess, and I'll put the kettle on. It's so lovely to get together again, like old times."
As Mum and I go our separate ways, the words rattling around inside my head are, "Yes, but without Ben." At least it isn't with Ben and his recently acquired girlfriend, Naomi. I just couldn't stomach that right now. Not here at Renwenneth Farm.
"Jess!"
Ivy leaps out of the passenger door the second the car stops moving.
"OMG! This is all looking fabulous. No more creepy vines obscuring the windows. It's so pretty now."
We hug like long-lost sisters as she gazes over my shoulder at the farmhouse.
"You pulled it off, Jess. I knew you would. And I'm so glad you kept that wisteria."
I simply couldn't bring myself to cut it down to ground level. The way the main stems intertwine beneath the sitting room window and then branch out either side forms a perfect heart shape. The now much smaller canopy of new growth runs along above the top of the ground floor windows and the front door, making the front of the old stone farmhouse picture perfect. "It takes my breath away," Ivy sighs. "Oh, it's so good to have you here again. Feels like forever, and yet, what is it, 5 months? "Yes, I'm really sorry," she responds, pulling away. "I'm at the Emporium 6 days a week. Sundays, I'm wiped out. I can only take time off when I get someone to cover for me, I'm afraid." "I understand, Ivy. You don't have to explain." "But I promised you I'd help whenever I can," she beams at me. "And you are. We've that little lot to shift, and there's no one else I could ask, is there?" Adam walks towards us, smiling. "It's like a different place already," he remarks, closing in for a hug. "It's good to see you thriving here, Jess, and Lola is growing like a weed. Must be all that wonderful country air." I gaze across at her. She trots along next to Dad, carefully carrying a tray of 6 plants as if they're as fragile as hen's eggs. "Yes, she is, Adam. How are things with you?" He lifts his right hand, rocking it from side to side. "The company I'm contracted to have a new guy in charge, and he's piling on the pressure. A job takes as long as it takes, but he thinks we should work more efficiently. I swear, if I hear that word one more time, I'm going to explode." Glancing up at his face, he does look a little hot and bothered. "I've been there and have the t-shirt. Don't take it personally, Adam." "I keep telling him the same thing, Jess. Bosses come and go, so..." The sound of a tooting horn as yet another car pulls into the farmyard makes all three of us turn around. "Oh, it's one of my neighbours, Erica. Go on inside. Mum's in the kitchen making tea and coffee. I'll be straight in. There's been a change of plan as Cappy wasn't feeling up to travelling. You're staying in Pentygrown if you want to put your things in there." "We can do that later," Adam replies, looking purposefully at Ivy. "I'm up for grabbing a coffee and making a start. After 3.5 hours in the car, I'm raring to go." "I guess we'll get the tour to see what you've been up to at lunchtime then, Jess." Ivy rolls her eyes as I head off to see Erica, Lola's best friend Daisy's mum. Erica opens the boot of her car and disappears from view as I call out, "Morning!" She appears in front of me carrying a tray covered in a tea towel. "Jess, seems I've arrived just in time. Daisy and I baked these for your visitors. We figured they'd need something hearty before the work begins." "Oh, bless you, Erica," I reply gratefully, taking the tray from her. "Saffron buns and my grandma's recipe buttermilk scones. It's just a little thank you for doing the school run all week with Daisy." "It's no problem at all. How's your mum doing?" She pulls a face. "On the mend, but she's not one to listen to advice. Her biggest gripe is her hair. Apparently, I don't have the knack, and that arm won't be fit to use for a few weeks yet. Bones don't heal overnight, so I'm taking her to the hairdresser's later this morning." "Can't be easy for either of you," I empathise. I can imagine that Erica's mum isn't exactly a patient, I muse to myself. She's a woman who doesn't hold back if she isn't happy about something. "These are double wrapped, so they might still be warm. I'll leave you to it." "My," she glances at the mass of jumbo bags of chippings. "You've certainly got your work cut out for you. Charlie says if you need a hand, just give a call. He's working night shifts this weekend, but if you get stuck, he said he can surface at noon tomorrow and is available until 5 o'clock. "Oh, that's really kind of him, Erica. I'll bear that in mind, but I'm sure we'll soon make a dent in that little lot." Charlie Godden is a paramedic, and the night shift can't be easy, especially as it's a long one. As soon as Lola's room is finished, Daisy must come for a sleepover to christen it. Erica gives me a wink. "I told you not to worry, and the day would come. I'm seeing the changes in Lola with each passing week, Jess. Anyway, the sun is shining and you'll be eager to get your team to work. Hopefully that tray will fuel them."
Chapter 3. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.